Hello, this is Roine Stolt, and you are listening to Sonic Perspectives.
Flower Kings album coming out later this month, and so it's the perfect time to talk with Roine Stolt about this new album and everything else going on in your world. Welcome to the call, Roine.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, are you at home right now? Are we talking to you at home?
Oh, absolutely. I'm at home. I actually arrived about an hour ago from... the southern part of Sweden, where I spent like 10 days recording again, not for Flower Kings this time, but with Transatlantic. So we're working on the fifth album, and I just finished that today and just arrived home.
Wow, welcome back. Boy.
Yeah, to start the interviews.
From one project to another.
Yeah, I know. Crazy. It is crazy.
Yeah. Yeah. So how did those sessions go? You said 10 days you were recording.
Yeah. Yeah. Or I would say recording, writing. It was probably more like a writing session per se. It's because we get together and we throw all these ideas on the table, you know, and we play a little bit, we jam a little bit, and like magic after this 10 days, we have whatever, like 70 minutes of music, you know. So, it's a different way of writing music or communicating. I mean, normally people would send stuff, you know, on the internet, but there's something happening when we actually get together and we're in the same room. I think that's more like in the old days, you know, we actually like to be in the same room because there's something happening, you know, the chemistry is different being in the same room than sending files back and forth.
Right. So you really didn't send material out to each other ahead of time?
Well, I did, but I think I got something from Neal just one day before I left here to go to the studio. So I didn't hear much, you know, and Pete sent something, and then he may have sent something a couple of days before we got together also. So there hasn't been an awful lot of time for us to digest the music, really. So it's another way of working.
Yeah. Right?
Whatever works, you know, if there's music coming out of it, it's all good.
Oh, absolutely. And you guys have quite the track record already for succeeding in that form. But so what does that look like? You've spent 10 days together. You've been writing. Like at the end of that, do you have a certain amount that's actually been recorded? Has the whole album been written at this point and maybe only parts of it recorded? Or where are you?
No, also the album is written, but then possibly Mike will retrack some of the drums. Pete may retrack a little bit of the bass. Neal will get home and he will probably overlook the what kind of keyboard sounds will be used for certain sections, and basically the same thing for me. You know, I go home and then I pick whatever guitar I think, you know, acoustic guitars, electrics, different kind of sounds and electric sounds that can be used for certain sections, you know. And then we start building the dynamics of the album, you know, because sometimes it's small, sometimes it's super big, sometimes it has one voice, and sometimes we're thinking of many layers of voices or choirs and stuff like that. So it's sort of a template that we can work from. But I mean, as far as the, it's just, I know it's a strange way of working, but this is sort of the, see, it's sort of like the skeleton or the, like the steel construction that we will build, you know,
right.
Put all the glorious, whatever, marble or, you know, the woodworks top of it, or, you know, the feathers or the colors or, so that's the way we work, you know, and today you can do that, you know, because of computers and stuff like that. So
right. So you have the album pretty much written now, and maybe the skeleton of the drum and the bass are already recorded, and now you just go in,
yeah,
and add from there. You build it up from there.
Yeah, I mean, even the guitars, I bet there's probably like 30-35% of the guitar work I put down will be used, you know. And then I will sit down now and listen to what sounds I like, and if I maybe have another, you know, play the Stratocaster on that one, and maybe there's going to be some acoustic or some 12 string or some slide guitar or lap steel or ukulele or whatever, you know. That's all different kinds of stringed instruments, and even I play some keyboards too, so there's going to be mellotrons and stuff put in there once we have the song ideas, structures that we have now constructed in the studio.
So how did it feel being back with the guys? Are you excited? Is this rejuvenating for you guys now?
It's exciting, and it's kind of I would say it's strange, because it's you can in the same time you can feel like the pressure to come up with something that's, you know, I personally feel like that the Whirlwind is probably our best album, and I that sort of would be sort of benchmark, you know, album for me, and I'm kind of scared to see if we can come up with something that is equally great, you know, as the Whirlwind. Maybe we can, but it's too early to tell, you know. And that's sort of the goal, to make something that's even greater. I mean, for every band, that's the way it works, you know.
Right.
You step in and try your best, that's all you can do.
Do you have hopes that this fifth one might reach that bar from what you've heard already?
I couldn't tell. I'm always very careful to say too much. And I mean, it goes for Transatlantic or for Flower Kings or anything I'm working on. It's like some people are, oh, this is the greatest album we've done ever, you know. And I think maybe, I hope it is, but, you know, you never know.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like then you're looking back, and then you can maybe say, in the case of the Flower Kings, I'll say, okay, maybe Start As We Are is my favorite album, or Unfold the Future. Those are the sort of the peaks, and then there's some other really good albums.
So I'm curious, I know that you got, most of you in Transatlantic, except for Pete, got to play on Cruise to the Edge last February. Did being together there help to inspire you to maybe finally start moving towards recording that fifth album?
I don't know, really. It just happened to be that we were all on the boat, so it seemed like it was Mike's idea to get... I mean, if I be 100% honest, I think things like that is not really what I think is... it could be fun, and I do understand for the audience. I always want to go in, and I want to be really prepared, and with a sound crew that knows the band. Is kind of complicated with all the setups with guitars and voices and keyboards, and so we need a good monitor system. To just go up and play something like that doesn't really come off, I mean, the way you hope. It's fun. I understand it's great for the audience, but I think as far as the quality of the music, I would, if you go up as a band like Transatlantic, then I think it should be well rehearsed and
right.
But that's just my personal view, you know. So it's always nice to meet the guys and play together, but I'd rather do it under very sort of controlled forms of rehearsing and with the sound crew, and so you can actually play the music well. That's all.
Sure. Yeah. And so for this new recording, do you have a sense how long it might be? Like, are you aiming for a release date? And I know all of you are on board that Cruise to the Edge again next March.
We hope to finish up the recording this year, but then there's going to probably be mixing over the beginning of next year, and that means possibly a release sometime next summer or end of next summer. Right. That's what I think is realistic.
So let's dive into the new Flower Kings album that's coming out, Waiting for Miracles. So it seems like this phrase, you know, waiting for miracles, is woven throughout much of the album. What's behind that phrase and using it as the album title?
Well, using it as an album title was something that's usually when you have a collection of songs and in the middle of everything, in the making of demos, in the making of backing tracks at the studio, and just trying to get, you know, these tracks done. You know, you every now and then over dinner or something, you're having talks about anything from artwork to album title, or what should we name the songs, because the song titles that you have on the album is actually not the song titles that we have as the working titles. That could be something else, you know. But then I think someone in the band just suggested a few possible album titles, you know, and it seemed like the majority felt like Waiting for Miracles was something that was probably taken from one of the song lyrics, I think. So it seemed to most of the band like something that was fitting, you know, if you look at the album as a whole. And you could say, of course, that the a lot of or some of the lyrics are kind of pessimistic and like a reflection of the state of what we see today in the world, you know, in many places. And so in a way, we're sort of waiting for things to get better, you know, maybe we're waiting for miracles. So I think that was the basic idea.
Mm-hmm. And then we have the track Miracles for America as well.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you live in America actually?
I do. I'm in Colorado. Yeah.
Colorado. Yeah. Yeah. Colorado is nice. Yeah. I love Colorado. But I mean, how do you feel? I mean, without getting in too much into politics, how do you feel about the state? Because it was interesting now with bringing in Transatlantic again, because we never talked politics before in this band. Mm-hmm. I thought the guys were completely uninterested in politics. But now it seemed like one of the first things we talked about when getting together, we talked about politics and of course, American politics. And the guy in the office, you know, so that seemed to be interesting to them also now. And I think it's we're all watching, you know, and we're very aware of, you know, the situation and so it's you can't really look away, even if we're in Europe, you know, and even if we're in Sweden, and Sweden have been saved from conflicts, I would say, for the last couple of hundred years, you know, whereas other parts of Europe have been sort of had problematic times, you know, with the World War, and we did stay out of the World War, you know, with the first and the second, and we were sort of saved, and even before that, so Sweden hasn't been really involved in any conflicts, and it's a good place to live, I have to say, but we can sense it even here, you know. It's like things are changing, and it's a bit, you know, the world is a little bit colder now than it was even like 30 years ago. So we're just watching from here, you know, and
it's telling that that you guys in Transatlantic did start talking about that immediately. And I mean, of course, you've woven some politics into your music all along, but you know, people like Neal doesn't really do that, and I guess in Marillion they do to an extent, but yeah, it's very much at the fore, and I I like that phrase, actually. I think at this point we are waiting for a miracle. We do need some miracles in America for sure, as things are getting more and more ramped up.
Yeah, and we're certainly waiting. I'm waiting for something to happen, but something got to happen very very soon, rather sooner than later, if you know what I mean. Because before everything is lost, but I think it will. But it's, you know, just hoping. So that's, I mean, even if you look now at the album cover, you see this elephant, and I think it was interesting because this is actually a guy from Colorado that made the album cover.
Oh, Paint Kevin Sloan is from Colorado.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. Yeah, and I wasn't aware of him. I just happened to go online and search for things, and then, you know, you point it to something or someone, and then it goes on and on, and then suddenly you find something and think, oh, that's nice. And I started looking at his page, you know, of paintings, because this guy is actually, it's someone that paint, I mean, with a brush on a canvas. So it's not like he's making stuff up in computer. So my aim was to have something that was sort of handcrafted, that was real, you know,
nice.
Not made up. Because many album covers now are computer generated. You can do fantastic stuff, but I felt like the handmade approach, and of someone who could actually paint, you know, or drawers, and who is a real artist in that sense. And I found his stuff, and I found all his elephants. I found the other stuff he does with anything from butterflies to fish, lots of animals, and sometimes you get stuck on certain things, you know, but he has some favorite motifs that he come back to, you know. So this elephant you can find in different environments, you know, in different shapes and forms, but I found this one with the elephant standing on the house of cards. That was sort of, I felt, okay, this is what's happening right now.
Right.
We're like, with the global warming and everything, this elephant is standing in the house of cards, but it doesn't work out really.
Right.
It works out for a couple of seconds, but soon the cards are gonna, you know, just fold, and, you know, so. And the other one that you can't see, but that's inside the album cover, is like a globe, this our planet. And it's hanging on a very thin thread, and they're like swirling butterflies around it. These are beautiful paintings, but also there's something about them that goes well with the lyrics, I think. So I try to pick from what he had. I try to pick certain things that I felt like. And the other one is like an octopus on the back. There's an octopus watching this, like this treasure trove thing, you know. So it goes well with the pirate theme for Black Flag, but also it, you know, someone watching and guarding this treasure trove, you know, the money and all that. So we try to pick a few things that sort of did work out with the lyrical content of the album, but still they're great paintings, and there's like a certain vibe, and they're actually hand painted. So that was the aim, you know, and to try to be a little bit different than what we have done and what other bands do also.
Yeah, you've got a perfect fit there. That was a really good call. And going to the music on the album, there's, you know, many gorgeous pieces of lead guitar, as usual, on tracks like The Rebel Circus and The Bridge. Do you approach your guitar playing differently depending on who is in the band?
No, not really. Not really. It's all very spontaneous, and I don't think much about it, really. I mean, every now and then maybe I can think, oh, maybe I shouldn't go too heavy here, or maybe I shouldn't play too fast, or maybe I should have this kind of sound that would fit the song, you know. But generally I just plug in and play whatever comes to mind, because that, I think it works, you know. It's not like a lot of thought go into it. I think it usually works best. It's this kind of the subconscious working for me, and if that tells me, oh, go this way, you know. And it doesn't matter if this this band or The Sea Within, or I'm playing with John Anderson or whatever, you know, I try to just go with feels right at the moment, and then hopefully, you know, other people like it too. So that's probably the approach I had recording these songs too, you know. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I may look back and I think, oh wow, there's not a lot of guitar in there. That's quite, you know, it's kind of keyboard oriented, and I tend to indulge in the keyboard layers and stuff like that too, and think, oh, where did my guitar go? So I, oh, come on, I'm a guitar player. I got to put some guitar in there, you know. Mm-hmm. But we try to find the balance, you know, that's nice, and that works, and still sort of the signature sound lies in the orchestration, but also, of course, in my guitar playing and also in our voices, mine and Hasse's. So that's part of the sound too.
As you're writing the material, at what point do you know whether you are going to be the lead vocalist or Hasse?
That's pretty spontaneous too. I just write the songs. I, of course, think of certain things that, oh, this will be, because a Hasse has a higher range than me, quite a bit actually. Mm-hmm. So he can hit those really high notes. I can't. And I can sing the lower notes with more like power than he can. So we're, in a way, it's a perfect match, you know, for covering the lower register all the way up to the super high. Mm-hmm. And he just come here to my studio and I just play the songs to him, and I may suggest, oh, what if you sang this, you know, how does that feel for you? And he try, oh yeah, that works, that's a perfect key and it sounds right, and it feels okay for him to sing, I mean, as far as the lyrics and everything. So I think we're not like we're not a band that plan everything really. It's more like, I wouldn't say we're jamming, because there's an idea, but we're trying to go with, you know, the impulse you get, you know. Okay, I put on the tape, run a song, we hear it, I point out maybe, what if you sing this, you know, sing the verse or sing the chorus here, and he sing it, and we just look at each other and say, oh, we're just nodding and, you know, yeah, okay, let's do it. And I just press record and we go. You know, and then you can hear it back and say, oh, yeah, this is great. Or maybe you hear it back the next day and say, that didn't really work out, you know. So very spontaneous, I would say.
Right. With this lineup for the band, you know, you and Jonas and Hasse, and now joined by Zach and Mirko, is it, on drums?
Yep.
Yeah, you were all able to tour for a while in the past year. And yeah. So did being able to do a lot of live gigs together when you came into the studio, did you feel strong and tight as a unit, as the band?
Yes, I think so. I mean, there's a really good vibe going in the band right now. And I think I have to give credit to the two new guys, because they bring in all the enthusiasm and I mean, maybe what has been lacking for a while, you know, they come in with lots of ideas, and they write music, and they are enthusiastic about just being here and playing the music, even playing the old songs. But I mean, the new album, they contribute quite a bit, you know. Mm-hmm. So I think that helps the rest of us, for me and Jonas and Hasse, to sort of sharpen our skills, or sort of be alert to, you know, just trying to make the best possible album and taking chances and trying different things. And so I think it's a very good time for the band, you know, and the touring definitely helped to sort of gel, you know, as friends, because you have to be friends too, you know.
Yeah.
You can make music together, but there has to be a good vibe, and you have to be, you know, on friendly terms, and you know, you have to like each other. You have to like your contributions as far as the music. You have to like each other even as persons, you know. Mm-hmm. So I think that's where we arrive now. And so I think it's just, I mean, we're just lucky to be right now. Maybe it doesn't go on forever. I don't know. I can't tell. But right now it feels really like the band is creative, and we like to play the old songs. We like to create this new music, and we like to look into the future, you know, and plan things and, go elsewhere and play. And so it's, I think it's a good time for the band, actually.
Yeah, I'm really glad to hear that. When we spoke last year, you explained that the Manifesto of an Alchemist album was credited as Roine Stolt's The Flower King, largely due to the record label's request at the time. And then then you guys went out on the road and as kind of a Flower Kings Revisited. And now you're fully called The Flower Kings again. Are these slight variations just semantics as far as you're concerned, or is it important to you?
No, it's not. It's not the least important to me, to be honest. I simply don't care. I just wanted to make it smooth. I just wanted to not upset people. I just wanted it to work out, you know, with the record label and everything, you know. And I think in reality, this is just another version of the Flower Kings. There's no doubt about it. It's not like it's suddenly Roine Stolt's band. It's the Flower Kings. Hass is there. Jonas is there. Yes, there's another drummer. We had many different drummers in the band before. And there's another keyboard player, yes. But we also had another keyboard player filling in for Thomas. You know, we've been to South America, we've been to America, we've been touring in Europe with another keyboard player before. So I think in some strange way, it seems like the music itself just lives on, even if changing a few members, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I usually say like, oh, you can probably change every member, including myself. But then someone protests, oh, no, you can't do it without you. And I maybe that's true, but I don't know. In reality, I think every member can be changed. It will sound slightly different. But then again, certain things have to be there maybe to create the specific sound of the band. And I think in particular, I think is the vocals, I think. The vocals of me and Hasse. So I think even if there was another guitar player and if Hasse's and my voices are there, I think it would sound like the Flower Kings. And of course, the songwriting part of it.
Yeah, but, I would think most people would name the guitar, your guitar playing as being pretty essential to the band. It would be hard to imagine that not being there and still being called the Flower Kings.
Yeah, maybe so. So, but we don't think much about it. It's, no. I mean, the band is working out and we're happy and people are, you know, very enthusiastic about playing live, about rehearsing, about recording new music, about writing new music. And that means we're in a good spot, you know. So we just, you know, thank whoever we should thank, you know. But we just give thanks to the fact that we can do this right now and after whatever, almost 25 years. And it's still fun, you know. And even go out and play the old songs. I mean, the two new guys, they're playing new music. But for me and Hass and Jonas, we're playing songs that we played 20 years ago, and it's still fresh and fun to play it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In some Flower Kings fans' minds, though, of course, they will think that Flower Kings are primarily Roine and Thomas. And so just the absence of Thomas will still be a question mark for some people. Is that just that you two are going in different directions at this point?
Yeah, you can say that's probably what it is, you know. And it's, I would say sometimes you grow to be more together, better friends, and sometimes you just grow apart as musicians or people. And it's not the end of the world, I think. It's just like, I mean, there's no doubt Thomas' contribution to the band over the years has been there, you know. And as I said, we had other keyboard player too, but I think sometimes fans read in too much into, so this guy isn't there anymore, and then it can't be the Flower Kings, etc. And I think that was never the case, you know, because you had other, I would say, Hasse, the voice of Hasse is equally as important, and over different times certain members have been more involved, you know, and we had like whatever 5, 6, 7 different drummers. Sometimes they've been involved, you know, in the music, and sometimes they have been really not been more like a studio session drummer, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's shifting all the time. So it's, and I think it's very romantic thought that, you know, it should be like these guys, Paul, George, John, and Ringo, and should be them and no one else, you know.
Yeah.
Or Mick or Keith or Brian Jones or whatever. But in reality, I mean, I even look at Yes, all the incarnations of Yes that's been going, you know, and they're going on and on and on, and with different people and different music, and sometimes it's more Yes and sometimes it's less Yes, you know, but it's the way it works. Mm. in reality, in life, and that's where the Flower Kings are right now. And for me personally, the energy that you feel when you're recording or you're rehearsing or you're playing music live on stage is super important to me, because that's why I stopped a couple of times with the Flower Kings, because I felt there wasn't any, I don't know, there wasn't a vibe really. Mm. We just, a good band playing, yes, we sounded fine, but there wasn't a vibe. There was no friendship, there wasn't a vibe. And if you can get to a point where everyone is sort of aiming at the same, in the same direction, you know, I think that's a good place to be. And it goes for every band. It doesn't matter. It happens to everyone. It's not like the Beatles gonna last forever. It's not like any band gonna last forever. Right. That's gotta be, I mean, whatever. There's Grateful Dead out there playing now, you know. Jerry Garcia is gone, but, you know, other people play, and it will sound different. It will be different, and here we are with the Flower Kings, almost 25 years later. And I mean, in all honesty, it's a lot of it is based around my works and my writing, etc., as well as my playing, of course. But I think the writing and the ideas coming from me a lot over the years. So that means, like, yes, probably. I'd be the sort of the last member to go, because without me, there probably wouldn't be the band, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Which is fine. But I mean, there's been people coming in and out, and I mean, it's interesting now because on this new album, my brother, who was the bass player in the band from the beginning, he's playing on I think 3 or 4 songs on the new album.
On the Waiting for Miracles album, he's playing bass.
Yeah, yeah. I think he plays on 4 songs.
Oh.
So he came back, I mean, for fun, because, you know, he was there in the beginning and now he's back helping on this album because Jonas had other commitments for some time. And so he just came in and helped a little bit with the bass and singing a bit, you know. And so it's nice. It's an ongoing story.
yeah, nice. Hey, you mentioned the Beatles there, and I was just curious. I mean, I'm sure you guys were too busy recording, but since you were all together in Transatlantic and you're such Beatles fans, I'm wondering if you've listened yet to the new deluxe edition of Abbey Road that came out.
I have not. I will do, but I have probably Mike has it already.
Yeah.
I bet he has, but I haven't. But I don't know. I think I have to listen to it, but at the same time, it's, I don't know. Sometimes you prefer the old recordings, and
mm-hmm.
We will see. I mean, I've heard some remixes of other bands, and I've heard, of course, the Let It Be Naked, the Beatles Let It Be album,
mm-hmm.
which I kind of liked the way, you know, it was stripped. And I've heard some of Steven Wilson's remixes of Yes albums and King Crimson albums, which sound fine to me, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I wouldn't say it's priority, but it's another way of sort of making the album, taking them into the spotlight again, I suppose, making some more money and all that.
Yeah.
And for fun, I don't know. I mean, it probably would be sanctioned by Paul McCartney and Ringo, I suppose. So it's interesting. I will check them out.
Yeah. So you guys will be going out on the road this December with Kayak.
Yes, that's right.
How do you decide how much of the new album to play in your set, considering you have such a long discography at this point?
Yeah, it's. I would say you have to be realistic about how many people will hear the new album before we, you know, go on stage and play these shows, and also how the album will be received, and the the fact that I think there's something about playing old songs that just works really well, you know, because I think people buy concert tickets to whatever, you know. If you're going to see Roger Waters, you probably don't want him to play all of his new album. I think it's a good album, but I think when I went to see him, I think he played three songs from the new album.
Right.
Rest was maybe something from his solo, the Hitchhiking album, but I think it was mostly old Pink Floyd songs.
Mm-hmm.
And that's based on the fact that I think most people in the concert hall will want to hear songs they know really well, they have connected to for whatever 40 years, you know. And in the case of the Flower Kings, yes, we have some songs that, like Stardust We Are and The Truth Will Set You Free, these songs has to be played, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then we lift in a couple of songs from the new album, and then bit by bit, you know, you can sort of change around the set list and see what people like and see what the band like to play. And over time, we're probably going to change it. We're going to change the old songs to from some other albums. And there's a lot to pick from, you know. There's like these, whatever, 10 or 12 studio albums up till now. So we're not short of songs, really, to play.
No.
It's just... it's a lot out there already.
Yeah. And then next year, hopefully some more touring with the band?
Oh, definitely. I mean, we're in the... There's a lot happening right now. So we're, you know, doing this transatlantic session. I'm usually in the mornings, you know, emailing and stuff. You know, we're going to Japan in late January, I think. And we're going back to Canada. We're probably going back to South America. We're doing more in Europe and I don't know, with the cruise, of course.
Mm-hmm.
In what's that? That's end of March or beginning of April, I think.
Right.
So, yeah, there's stuff coming up, and we're in the planning stages for all of next year, really. But in between all that, we're gonna sort of try to find time to record yet another album.
Nice. Wow.
Yeah, so it's just, you know, business as usual.
Yes, it is. It is. So with the...
I don't like the business side, but, you know, it's more like you got to have a plan, you know. It's not like you're sitting here waiting, but there's offers coming in and then you need to start looking into it and do all the deals and get all the proper visas for going places like Japan and whatever, South America, it's stuff like that. So, and we'll see where the transatlantic goes. Maybe there could be possibilities of touring there also next year.
Right, excellent. After the album comes out. Yeah, so with those, all that activity, do you have any space in your life for some of the other things, whether it's The Sea Within or John Anderson or Ned Sylvan or Kaipa, mm-hmm. Kaipa del Capo?
Kaipa del Capo has been on rest. We played a show a couple of weeks ago, but we're not planning really. Maybe with some writing. The other guys probably be in charge of that, and then I will add my stuff later on because... all these other things happening. And The Sea Within, I can't really see anything happening right now, not this year and maybe not next year, but I wouldn't rule out something happening in the future. Right now, Tom Brislin joined Kansas and Jonas is out with Steve Hackett. And
mm-hmm.
So it's just like, I think there's not really time for anything.
Mm-hmm.
And John Anderson, there's album number 2 in the works, at least. So we're sort of, I don't know, maybe 35, 40 minutes of music that were sort of trying to do some kind of a proper demo. But I think in there, I think is some really, really strong melodies and really good music. So it's just having the time to, because everything takes time, you know. Mm-hmm. And when you're into some project like now with Transatlantic, and just recently this summer I was mixing the Flower Kings album, you can't really juggle much more than that. It's enough. It's everyday work. And if I even started listening to any of the stuff that I did with John now, the new stuff, that would sort of just be frustrating to not be able to start working on it.
Exactly.
So it's just finding the right time when there is nothing, when the Flower Kings album is out and we're not on tour and I'm not working on Transatlantic, then I have maybe a couple of weeks, you know, I can start looking into it again and see where John is at the time, because he's probably working on stuff too, and mm-hmm. and his Thousand Hands tour and all that. So we'll see.
Yeah. Yeah, well, no lack of great projects and great music and great people to collaborate with. You're blessed to work with so many amazing people.
Yeah, yeah. You have to remind yourself, you know, it could be very different. It could be something else. I could be in a pub band or a bar band, you know, somewhere. I could be in a more regular job or as a music teacher or something. Mm-hmm. So that's something you have to remind yourself all the time, that it's a blessing to be able to travel and see the world and play with these great musicians, collaborate with people, you know, that have great ideas, and some of them are, like Hackett and with John Anderson, these guys were my heroes when I was a teenager, you know, and suddenly I'm there working with them, and so that's great, and be able to record and write all the music, you know, with people and new projects coming up all the time, It's something you shouldn't take for granted, because it happens to very few people. So I'm trying to be grateful every day, you know, for this possibility.
I'm sure you are, and you live in Sweden, so things might be getting a little darker, but not too dark there, hopefully.
No. I mean, America is not lost, so I think it's just we need to wait a little bit and see if things change, and I think it will change.
Yeah, eventually. Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. And since, just one last question, since you are in Sweden, I was curious, how did you woo the other three guys to come out there to you and record out there? It sounds like Mike has hardly ever recorded outside of America before.
No, that's what he said. He said we talked today, or yesterday we talked, and he said he never recorded an album outside of the United States. Well, the reality is, again, thanks to the way America is run now, it's difficulties to actually get a visa, a proper visa, mm-hmm. because you could, a couple of years back, you could. But now getting a visa I don't know how to put it, but you can apply for it, but there's no guarantee that you actually get it. You can, and then you have to invest a lot of money in it. So for me and Pete to try to get the visa to go into United States to record, because you need that too. It's not just for performing. Once you go into United States and you do something that will generate money, and they will find out, you know, because you're playing on a record, you're recording a record that's going to be released worldwide by Sony, they will find out. So the possibility is that you go there and then they stop you at the border and say, go home. And then we have set up a recording session. And so I tried to explain this to the other guys, and finally sort of the coin dropped, and okay, so we need to find somewhere else. And we looked at England and we looked at Sweden, and finally we found a studio in Sweden that was a nice and decent price. And I knew the studio because I've been there before. And so that was the reason we had to recorder in Europe, actually.
Wow.
That was the only safe or the only guarantee that we actually could get together, the four of us, and write, you know. And there's no time, because the other guys, Mike and Neil, are going out now doing some shows with Flying Colors, I think.
Right.
So there's like a schedule, and this was the only time, you know. So we ended up in Sweden, which was nice, I think, for me. And I think, I hope, hopefully they found the experience nice too, because it's, you know, it's different and a super nice studio. Very, I think, if you go to America or if you go to London, for instance, a studio like that, you can't really afford it. Mm-hmm. But this happened to be in the countryside, and this guy has this fantastic studio with, I mean, the biggest desk you can imagine and all the finest microphones, and everything is absolutely top-notch. And so it was a possibility for us to go to a really nice place and create the music and do backing tracks. And here we are. And I think the general feeling now is that we came out with something that will grow over the weeks now to something really good, and another great transatlantic album.
Mm-hmm. Well, Roine, thanks so much for talking with us today. Really excited about where transatlantic's going. I'm excited to hear about the energy in the band of the Flower Kings now, and the new album sounds great. I'm sure fans are going to just love this as it comes out. We're going to close the interview by playing Black Flag. Is there anything you'd like to say about that as an intro to the song?
Not really. There's lots of other people talking in the song. These are mostly pirates, I think. Now, the funny thing is, I would say the only thing I, as far as the music, I couldn't really say, because I'm probably too close to it. But the funny thing is, this theme of the pirate theme came up for whatever reason. I can't really tell why. It's just something I wouldn't write a song like that 15 years ago, but probably there was something in my mind telling, oh, you should probably try something different, you know. And I just came up with this fiction that could be, of course, you know, the pirate thing happened back in the 1700s or 1600s. It happened because certain people were outcast, you know, in England, for instance, and they had to go somewhere, and then suddenly they had to survive, so they go robbing other ships, you know, at sea, and so they take from the queen, you know, that was just seemed like in a way, a fitting theme that goes well together with the other songs on the album. I wouldn't say political, but it's a story, and you can make whatever you want from it. But at the same time, it was like a pure fiction, fantasy, pirate thing, you know. There's some thought about, you know, if you look back at that time, you know, in the 1600s and 1700s, and why everything happened, you know, I think it connects in a way, I think, with every all things, you know, that we're seeing right now. So who knows? There will be pirates. There are actually pirates right now too. I mean, in Africa, you can actually get your ship boarded by pirates, but they don't look that way anymore. They don't have the black flags and stuff like that. So that's kind of the odd song on the album, I think. And it's, musically speaking, it's probably a little bit different than other Flower King songs, but also has elements of well-known sounds and playing that you can hear from way back also.
Mm-hmm. I think it's a great opener and great for a single to release to folks. So thank you so much, and all the best to you, and welcome home.
Yep. Thank you. I will enjoy a quiet evening now, I think. Hopefully, we will see. Okay.
All right, take care, Roine.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thanks for listening to our interview with Roine Stolt, everybody. Hope you enjoyed it. And consider subscribing to our Sonic Perspectives YouTube channel to get the latest news, interviews, and reviews. You can also follow us on Facebook and Twitter, of course. And we're going to now close the show by playing that track that Roine was talking about from the latest Flower Kings album. This is called Black Flag.
We have come to pray for wind, one more wild adventure to begin. There's 100 million stars, 1,000 grains of salt upon my skin.
Tonight.